I'm aboard a ship that performs the most complex and most dangerous operations in the entire US Navy. It has a massive flight deck, but it's not an aircraft carrier. See, aircraft carriers deal with problems from far away by launching aircraft. But amphibious ships deal with crises face to face by putting Marines on the ground. Of course, the flight deck of an aircraft carrier remains to be one of the most dangerous places to work. But when it comes to complexity of operations, amphibious ships have no rivals.
It's gonna be tight.
They're the only platform that requires the integration of two forces, Navy sailors and Marines. They're also the only ships that operate a well deck as well as a flight deck, which makes amphibious operations extremely sensitive to weather conditions. In fact, they have 11 people on the ship whose only job is to analyze and forecast the weather. And if you still remain unconvinced, consider this. Within just 6 hours of receiving an order, an amphibious ship must be ready to mobilize its Marine Expeditionary Unit for a mission. For an aircraft carrier, that planning cycle is 72 hours. But while USS Bataan carries a massive refueling rig, even though it could pretty much steam around the world without ever needing to refuel. While the ship operates AV-8 Harriers, but not F-35Bs, even though both aircraft can take off and land vertically. And why, if you're good at Tetris, you may have a career with the US Navy, is not what you think. If you could park a drone on top of a supercarrier and look down, you will see the same thing happening day after day, launching and recovering aircraft. Amphibious ships, on the other hand, are a lot more versatile, given that they can operate aircraft as well as watercraft. But this versatility comes at a price. Sea conditions can have a significant impact on well deck operations. For example, low tides can turn a bay into a mud flat within hours. This means beach landings need to be coordinated, such that troops and equipment don't get stuck on the beach for hours until the tides come back. But this is where USS Bataan's 11 weather specialists come into the picture. 6 assistant forecasters deploy devices that measure oceanographic information every hour, and 5 weather forecasters produce predictions every 12 hours. These predictions are an essential input into well deck operation planning. The well deck on USS Bataan is like a giant garage that opens to the water. This allows certain types of amphibious vehicles to get in and out of the well deck. A flooded well deck looks kind of like a big swimming pool, so I had to ask the question.
Would you ever do a swim call inside the well deck?
It's been done before. It's very unsafe though, because when you flood an open space like this, and this is a large space, you get something called the free surface effect. So when the water sloshes around, it bounces off the walls, and it's very unsafe for people.
LCUs are one of the primary watercraft used for transportation of troops, vehicles, and cargo to shore.
So we can take 2 LCUs, which is landing craft utility, they're actual boats. They need 6 to 8 feet of water in the well deck in order to come in. So we drop the stern and the stern gate and we flood it and the craft come in. And then we can also take LCACs.
LCAC, or landing craft air cushion, is another popular method of ship-to-shore transportation. Since LCACs can simply hover, the well deck doesn't need to be flooded for them. LCACs are much faster than LCUs, but they can carry only half the payload. It may not look like it, but LCUs actually have living accommodations and can sustain a crew of 13 for 10 days. Getting an LCU to come into the well deck is a bit of an ordeal.
So when the craft are coming in, my sailors, the bosun's mates, or the seamen are up on these wing walls with lines, and they throw the lines over to the LCUs, and they actually have to adjust how the craft is coming in.
On the other hand, an LCAC can come into the well deck without any external help, but it's a very tight entry. There's only about 1 foot of space on each side, which is why the craft has bumpers all around, in case it hits the sides of the well deck. Another interesting fact about LCACs and LCUs is how they can link up inside the well deck.
you'll have three LCACs at a time or two LCUs at a time, and their ramps connect. So they're able to have the vehicles on the furthest LCU or LCAC drive across all of the others to enter or exit the well deck up into the storage area.
And managing that storage area is a challenge in and of itself. Weighing at 27,000 tons, Wasp-class ships are the heaviest man-made objects to ever be rolled across land. They can also carry a massive amount of cargo. That said, loading all the equipment into the ship is like playing Tetris, but in three dimensions. One dimension is loading everything efficiently and making use of all the available space. The second dimension is the order at which everything is loaded. For example, if the ship's headed to a contested area, certain equipment needs to be offloaded onto the shore first. You wouldn't want those things buried behind all the other cargo. The third dimension has to do with the weight of the cargo. Remember, all this equipment adds a significant amount of weight to the ship. So it's critical to load everything in a way that keeps the ship balanced. The planners also need to ensure that there are open lanes between the cargo for fire protection and other safety considerations. To play this game of Tetris on the ship, a loading plan is generated in advance. Marines would then pre-stage everything that needs to be loaded, which could take up to a week. Then, as soon as the ship arrives at the pier, everything is loaded based on the loading plan. The hottest place on USS Bataan is the flight deck.
So these flight decks are very interesting. Wow, it's hot.
Of course, that was because of the sun. But when Aviate Harriers vertically land on this flight deck, they can make it very hot. In fact, the reason F-35s are not currently allowed to land on USS Bataan is because the intense heat generated by their exhaust can warp the flight deck. But this issue can be resolved, like they did on Bataan's sister ship, USS Wasp. The flight deck of USS Wasp has been coated with a special material called Thermion, which is extremely heat-resistant and extremely expensive. So only certain spots on the flight deck are treated, and those are the only areas that F-35s can land on without damaging the flight deck. There are no catapults and no arresting systems on this ship. This is why it exclusively houses US Marine aircraft, like the Harriers and Ospreys, which have short takeoff and vertical takeoff and landing capabilities. But it may also carry variants of helicopters like the CH-53, SH-60, and AH-1. Depending on the operation, the ship could carry different combinations of air combat elements. For example, in a full assault configuration, the air group can have as many as 22 Ospreys, while in a sea control configuration, USS Bataan carries upwards of 20 AV-8B Harriers, supported by 6 SH-60 Seahawk helicopters for anti-submarine warfare. Emergency landings on supercarriers are typically done with the help of a barricade to catch the incoming aircraft. But on USS Bataan, they have something much simpler. On June 7, 2014, Marine Corps Captain William Mahoney realized that his front landing gear had malfunctioned. Lucky for him, USS Bataan was equipped with a stool, specially made for scenarios like this. So with help from the control tower, the pilot was able to align the Harrier before eventually dropping the nose dead center on the stool. It's scenarios like this that necessitates the need for a massive crane like this, which can help move damaged aircraft out of the way. Right next to the crane, there is a small yet mighty fire truck. It holds 750 gallons of water and is always here on the flight deck on standby in case any fires need to be put out. Those on the firefighting duty need to wear this shiny suit, which is rated for 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit.
On a day like this, which is kind of hot, what does it feel like to have that thing on all day long?
It feels like a sweatsuit.
Luckily, they are on 2-hour rotations, which makes it easier on hot days. Yeah, I definitely wanted to try on the sweatsuit. It was actually more comfortable than it looked, and also a lot more expensive than I thought.
The jackets and the pants combined, $16,000.
Not a bad look. for a $16,000 suit. The hangar bay is where the aircraft are stored when they're no longer needed on the flight deck. Two elevators allow the aircraft to be moved between the flight deck and the hangar bay. These elevators are huge, so big that in order to transit the Panama Canal, the elevators need to be folded in. The hangar bay can also be used to perform maintenance on the aircraft, and there are shelves all around to store spare parts. For example, inside these giant boxes, helicopter blades are stored. Like any other Navy ship, firefighting equipment is accessible throughout the ship. Sailors do fire drills on a regular basis to gain familiarity with the ship's layout and equipment, and also to prepare for different scenarios. Now that's also what Marines do while underway, doing drills non-stop, in addition to eating and hitting the gym. Because the ultimate baton on USS Bataan is its Marines. Marine Expeditionary Units, or MEUs, are the crisis response force of the United States. And a crisis often demands a quick response. This is why it could take as little as 6 hours from the time an order comes in until a MEU has to be ready to execute that mission. This short planning window is called R2P2, short for Rapid Response Planning Process. R2P2 includes organizing and strategizing, deciding which aircraft needs to be deployed and bringing them to the flight deck, figuring out how many Marines and what kind of weapons must be put ashore, determining the best mode of ship-to-shore transportation based on the weather forecast, and so on. Aircraft carriers, on the other hand, typically operate under a 72-hour planning horizon. That's because their primary mission is not crisis response. They're often involved in theater response, which are large-scale operations like Desert Storm. What differentiates a MEU from other crisis response teams like the Navy SEALs or US Army and US Air Forces, IRF, is the ability to have air, logistics, ground combat, and command and control in one package anywhere in the world. The rapid response nature of amphibious operations is why ships like USS Bataan can do things like replenishment through the well deck, which can be very useful. During Operation Iraqi Freedom, USS Bataan was running low on ammunition. The issue was that receiving supplies using vertical replenishment meant that Bataan had to pause its flight deck operations. On the other hand, being replenished alongside meant that Bataan would be tied to the supply ship, limiting its maneuverability. So they did something that aircraft carriers cannot do. The supply ship first transferred the required ammunition to another amphibious ship that was nearby. That amphibious ship moved the supplies to its well deck and loaded them into LCACs. The LCACs then delivered the ammunition to Bataan through the well deck, which allowed the ship to continue its flight deck operations without interruption. Well deck replenishments can also be facilitated during a stern gate marriage. That's when an LCU and a ship align their stern gates. This allows for quick resupply missions from ship to shore or between two ships. Speaking of replenishment, USS Bataan carries about 1 million gallons of fuel. That's enough for the ship to pretty much steam around the world. But that doesn't explain why USS Bataan has its own refueling rig.
Our FAS 1 station, so FAS is fueling at sea. And then we have RAS stations, which is refueling at sea. So essentially, a RAS is when we're taking something from someone else. A FAS is when we're supplying to someone else.
Oh, I did not know that.
Yeah. So we can supply fuel to, say, a destroyer. They'll just come alongside, we'll connect our rig, and they can take fuel from us.
A destroyer would typically need to receive fuel every 3 days. But if for whatever reason an oiler is not available, an amphibious ship can act as an oiler. This giant refueling rig is specifically here for that reason. The US Navy likes to have fun with naming things on their ships. Remember the Broadway on USS New York? Well, this is Stairway to Heaven on USS Bataan. Can you guess what's behind this door? Well, if you guessed a stairway, you're right. The stairway leads to the bridge.
So this big ship is controlled with this little wheel here, tiny wheel. Look at this.
But this wheel is not the only navigation tool on this ship.
Yeah, it's amazing.
For personnel to navigate their way around the ship, there are these plates on the wall called the bullseye. They're similar to street signs, telling you where you are, but only if you know how to interpret them.
So what do these numbers on the plate mean, the first four numbers?
So the first number is the level you're on, up or down. Mm-hmm. So we're on the O2 level, so we're up from where we came in. This is the frame number, so how far forward and aft you are. This is from center line if you're port or starboard. So port is even numbers, starboard is odd. And okay. Then this last one is the type of space. So Lima means living space.
Living. What will be another example of another space?
E for engineering spaces, M for ammunition spaces, and W for water storage areas, to name a few. It could take up to a couple of months for someone new to fully know their way around without using the bullseye. Aircraft carriers are by and large designed for blue water operations, which means they operate from the middle of the ocean, as far as hundreds of miles at sea, whereas amphibious ships are designed to get close to the shore, as close as 10 miles out. This means that amphibious ships have to deal with two types of threats. Blue water threats that aircraft carriers too deal with when far from land, but also green water threats when they're close to shore. This includes things like torpedoes, mines, short-range anti-ship missiles, and drones. Plus, the closer a ship gets to shore, the higher are the chances of it being detected by the enemy, which eliminates the element of surprise. To deal with these threats, some prep work needs to be done. Harriers might take off from Bataan's flight deck to soften a target on land, which is military lingo for blowing things up. Marines may also get help from an aircraft carrier to level a particular coordinate. Prior to getting the LCACs and LCUs into the water, a reconnaissance team of four or five people would survey the area using a rubber boat. They look for mines that may be moored in the water, as well as checking the beach to ensure it's clear of landmines. Even though LCACs hover on the surface, they still exert some pressure on the water, which could trigger certain types of sea mines. If needed, an EOD team would first have to clear the beach. Only once a safe passage has been confirmed, Marines would be transported to the beach. Of course, if the target area is 150 miles inshore, instead of doing a surface insertion and then driving to the target area on Humvees, it might make sense to just do a direct vertical insertion with the help of V-22 Ospreys. Then Huey or Cobra helicopters may be sent out to suppress enemy fire while the Marines are brought in. With all this said, since Marines need to be transported off the ship and fight in proximity to the enemy, the rates of injury can be high. This is why the hospital on USS Bataan is much larger and better equipped than hospitals on aircraft carriers, even though they carry about half the personnel. Amphibious ships are also used for humanitarian assistance and disaster relief missions, making larger hospitals a necessity. A Marine Expeditionary Unit has the advantage of taking the fight to virtually any point on the enemy's coastline, but this comes at the cost of managing extensive logistical operations, overcoming environmental factors, and facing often heavily defended coastal areas. The transition from sea to land is the most vulnerable phase for Marines, since they can be targeted by the enemy. Countering this demands effective suppression of enemy defenses and rapid movement. The need to integrate naval, air, and land forces under urgent timelines is why such operations enabled by this ship and its crew are the most complex of military endeavors.